So my name is Jim Spates, and I have been involved with a wonderful group of people here in Geneva and some from afar for a little over 3 years now in an attempt to save the dump block in downtown Geneva. You see a picture of it, or at least an artist rendering of it, in the upper left-hand corner of the screen. It's a great building. I'm going to take a couple minutes to tell you why we're here, but before I do that, I really want to thank some people who worked extremely hard on this project. We're about, I think, at the midpoint of the project. Our goals were two. The first goal was to save the building. We're pretty sure we have done that, and saved it for Geneva. This is all nonprofit. We're just doing it because we think the dump block should stay alive in Geneva. And the second thing is to establish a gallery, which we're going to call the Dove Gallery, which is going to be a memorial to the life and artwork of Arthur Dove, our great native painter to Geneva, and a community art gallery as well. So we're going to do a couple of things with the gallery part of this. This is in a way, the kind of kickoff event of the second half of our campaign. So, but I forgot to tell you one thing about the building, and that is we have bought it. We are two groups. The first group is called the Dove Block Restoration Group, and almost everybody from that group is here in the audience today. Many deep, abiding thanks to all these folks. Many, many hours. All of the people in this room, I know almost all of you, have been on committees after committees for group after group. You've done wonderful work, so you know what I'm talking about. Thank you to everybody on the Dove Block Restoration Group. And they're in charge of saving the building. The second group is called the Arthur Dove Tribute Group, and they are in charge of getting the gallery up and running. So we're the group that's probably going on in more intensity as the building gets saved. So I'm going to show you a couple of pictures to give you a sense of where we've been. I'm not going to take very long to do this because I want to turn it over to Rachael because she's the one you come to see. That is the Dove Block, more or less as it looked about, I don't know, 60 or 70 years ago, right on the corner of Exchange and Castle Streets. And the former city mayor, city manager, his name was Matt Horn, he loved this project that we were involved in, and he said the Dove Block is on the corner of Main and Main. And that's I thought it was a wonderful metaphor, particularly as an urban sociologist. It is in the central place in the city. You see the arterial and the lake to the right of the circle. There's the Dove Block right on the corner of Exchange and Castle when you come into Geneva, whether you're coming from the north, whether you're coming from the south, whether you're coming from the east, you go right past the Dove Block. So it's a central building in terms of what we're doing. It was vacated in 2006 by the former owners. It went up for sale. And some lovely Genevans had a friend from England, and one of them is here today. And she, the friend from England, bought the building, and we essentially, in due course, bought the building from her about 12 years after that. So we're very happy to own the building. This is what it looks like today. Many of you know what it looks like. It's a gorgeous building. It's right on that wonderful corner. It's a late Victorian height, what's called High Victorian Gothic building, built by Arthur Dove's father, William Dove. Opened in 1876. And you see three stories. It also has a basement. The third story is where Arthur Dove, who's our artist, lived in 1937 and 1938. Lived there for about 16, 17 months straight. Was sponsored by a fellow from New York City whose name many of you who know anything about art know. His name is Duncan Phillips. He was the founder of the Phillips Collection, which is one of the great modern art collections in America, in Washington, D.C. He loved Arthur Dove. He loved Arthur Dove's work, and he gave Dove $50 a month to paint in the 1930s. Now we're in the middle of the Depression, so that's not so bad. So Arthur went up to that third floor and started to paint. And as you can see, painted Geneva. Those grain elevators used to be in Geneva. He painted those. He painted some things realistically in the beginning, like this. This is an early painting of Dove's, which is called Stuyvesant Square. The painting is in the admissions office at Hobart William Smith Colleges. We own it. It's just some 100 yards away, so you can go and have a look at it sometime. It's a wonderful painting. You can see it's sort of in Impressionist style. And then he went to Paris and came back. And he had changed. So he becomes the first person to work in abstraction, what we call abstraction in American art, and is very, very well known for all of those reasons. This one is called Morning Sun. He did it in 1935. He lived in Geneva from 1932 to 1938. Did dozens and dozens and dozens of his most important works while he was here. Here's one perhaps you know better. This one is at the Phillips Collection. This one is called Red Sun. It's sort of our logo picture. We love this. Well, I want to go back to that one for a moment. He used the natural environment for so many of his ideas about what to abstract out. So here you see, those of you who live in our area, many of you here, here you see the fields, and here you see the trees, and here you see the sun coming up in the morning, and here you also see the sun coming up on a cloudier morning like today. We think this one may have been painted on the roof of the dub block because there was access up there when he lived there. It's a really beautiful painting. He walked around Geneva all the time. Here's a view from the third floor, looking straight down Exchange Street going north. You see this, the spires of St. Peter's. You see the spire of North Press Church there in this lovely watercolor. So he did lots of things with a Geneva base from that third floor. Now I want you to look in the lower right-hand corner of the building here. That's the main entryway into the building over there. This is the sort of separate area which we call the storefront. And that's where we want the Dove Gallery to be. So we're going to fix this up. We're going to have a memorial to Dove, and we're going to have a community art center where local artists or sculptors or anybody interested in arts, we're hoping to have programs for children in the arts, educating school children, high school children, junior high kids in the arts, and so on. To have Geneva's never had anything like this. So that's really the motivation for doing it. Now, to get this done, we have to do a lot of work. This is only one shot, and if I took you through the Dove block as a whole, you would see that there's a lot to be done. So we have quite a bit of money from the state of New York to allow us to do the infrastructural work that'll begin this summer, and hopefully that'll get us ready. We want somebody else to buy the building. We are not landlords. We don't want to own the building for the rest of our lives, however long those things are. But what we want to do is we want to have somebody to buy the building and then support the gallery while they own the building in the downtown. So you see lots of work, lights, plumbing, air conditioning, everything you can think of needs to be redone in the building. So it's going to cost a lot of money. That's why you're all here today. We're hoping everybody won't leave until they give us, $500,000 check. We're delighted to have you. But anyway, we do have to raise a lot of money. And if we get the money in place, this is what it's going to look like. Well, we think this is what it's going to look like. So Jessica Vaughn is an architect in New York City. We hired her to do a rendering of what the gallery might look like when it is finished. And she did a wonderful job. So here's the entryway into the Dove block as one conception of how it will look. Here's where you go in. On your left, as you go in, there's going to be a big memorial wall to Arthur Dove. We're going to have an electric kiosk where you can look at all his works. We're going to have some of his works in large reproductions on the walls around. Every article that's been written on Dove will load into the kiosk so you can read it and find out about him and his time in Geneva in particular. And here's a long view of the gallery. Right? We're going to have, it's just going to be terrific. So we're closing in on that. We hope to get this done in a year or two, probably closer to two rather than one. We have a website, which you're all invited to visit. It's called the dubblockproject.org. And in-house design helped us design and did a fine job. It's a terrific website. We're very proud of it. And people like it, so you're welcome to go there. That's a lovely picture of Arthur. And we are going to save the Dove block for Geneva and have the Dove gallery. So that kind of brings you up to where we are. Now I'm going to introduce our speaker, whom you came to hear. Rachael Delue came to us, 2 years ago?
Mm-hmm.
2 years ago, Steve Chokum somewhere in the audience. Steve saw that she had given a lecture at the Terra Foundation on the most recent Arthur Dove that had sold. So I looked at that video of her telling the Terra Foundation why they did not make a mistake in buying a $5.7 million Arthur Dove painting.
That was, in fact, my brief.
Yes. So I called her up. She said she came. She came and spent 3 days with us. We introduced her to everybody. We gave her a walking tour of the Dove block. We asked her if she would be on our board. And she said yes, and we're delighted. So she is absolutely the right person because she's one of the world's ranking probably one of the two people in the world who know the most about Arthur Dove and his art. She has a recent book out called Arthur Dove, Always Connect. Mm-hmm. And it's out with the University of Chicago Press. She's the, let me get this right, she is the Christopher Binion Seraphim 1986 professor in American art in the Department of Art and Archaeology at Princeton University. She's published widely. I found out from reading her brief bio here that she's doing a work on the study of Charles Darwin's diagram of evolution as presented in The Origin of Species. Now, that's a very laudable goal. But I have been trying to talk Rachel into this for now well over a year, that her next book should be Dove in Geneva. Yeah. Who could do it better than Rachael Delue? Here's Rachael talking about Arthur Dove, his music, and his art. First part.
Okay, I'm just going to take a brief 30 seconds to switch out the technology so you can talk amongst yourselves while I do that. And if it's okay with all of you, I'm going to turn the lights down just a wee bit. Will that be all right? Yeah, okay. See if I can do that without putting us in total darkness.
So while she's doing that, we have some wine and cheese afterwards. We hope you will come and enjoy that with us, talk to us about it. Tell us if you'd like to be involved. We'd love to have you involved. So that'll happen, and after Rachel's done, she'll be happy to do some Q&A.
Is that too dark, or is that okay for you guys? All right. One more question. Can everyone hear me?
Yes.
All right. Great. So I'm really pleased to be here, and I didn't quite know what to expect when this fellow called me out of the blue a few years ago. But I said, well, I'm game, and I'm delighted that I'm a part of all of this. Dove is an artist, obviously dear to my heart. The paintings are incredible. They're very important to the history of modern art. And that, by extension, means that Geneva and the Dove Block are very, very important to the history of modern art. So I'm thrilled to be a part of this. And I want to thank the folks with whom I've been working for the past 2 years for everything they're doing. So this afternoon, I'm going to talk about the work of, obviously, Arthur Dove. There's a lovely photograph of him made by Alfred Stieglitz in around 1915. And as Jim said, Dove is an artist who is often described as the first creator of a fully abstract painting in the United States. And that may be the case. He's more interesting because he was the progenitor of a completely new kind of picture in the American context. His career spanned the first half of the 20th century. He was born in 1880 and he died in 1946. And he was, I should mention that this is a sketch, and let me get that arrow out of the way. That's not original to the sketch. This is a watercolor that Dove made. It's called Seneca Lake. And so he made it while he would wander around and sometimes make sketches in a notebook, but most often take his experiences and his memories back to his studio with him and sketch what he called his ideas. So this is an idea of Seneca Lake. So Dove, just to give you a little bit of background, I'm not going to spend too much time on this. Dove was one of several American artists in the early decades of the 20th century who were championed by Alfred Stieglitz, who was himself a photographer. That Stieglitz on the upper left, and a photograph from the Equivalence series that Stieglitz created. And that's a photograph that was created by Stieglitz pointing his camera up to the sky and photographing clouds. And if you're interested why he did that, he wrote a wonderful essay called Why I Came to Photograph Clouds. So it gives you all of the answers. So Stieglitz was a photographer, but he was also somebody who operated galleries in New York and served as a kind of crossroads between the European avant-garde and avant-garde art in the United States. And he supported many artists, among them Arthur Dove. Also, and this is on the right here, also Georgia O'Keeffe, who he wound up marrying. This is a beautiful charcoal sketch by her from around 1915, 1916. And he also brought to his galleries and supported exhibitions of the art of the European avant-garde. So that's a painting by Cezanne there on the lower left. So the artists that circulated through, both in person or by way of their art, in Stieglitz's galleries included Cezanne, Matisse, Brancusi, Picasso, Picabia, and then, of course, the Americans, Marsden Hartley, John Maron, Charles Demuth, Max Weber, Paul Strand, and, as I said, Georgia O'Keeffe. Now, along with other Stieglitz-supported artists, Dove, and this is in part why he's so important, he contributed to the development of a new artistic idiom, a new modern art idiom. And sometimes his paintings were abstract, and sometimes they weren't. Most often they sat kind of in the middle. This is a painting that he created in 1935 entitled Moon. And there's a way in which we can say to ourselves, yes, indeed, that is in fact a moon. But there is also a way in which we can say to ourselves, well, no, that is not at all a moon. It sits sort of in the middle of the real and the non-objective. And I'm putting it next to a painting by Robert Henri, who was a member of what was at the time, at the turn of the century, around 1900, called the Ashcan School, because they depicted the grit of New York streets. And I'm putting Dove's Moon next to Henri's painting, which is in a sense exemplary of what American painting looked like at the turn of the century, to show you in a sense exactly what Dove and his cohort did to American painting, getting from the Henri, and the Henri dates to about 1908 or 1912, to this picture in two decades is no small feat. Now, hang on. I think I lost. There it is. This is the painting that Jim showed you a moment ago, and Dove is perhaps best known for paintings like this, for the paintings that he painted in Geneva, that he painted after coming back in 1933 to his hometown. He wasn't born in Geneva, but he moved to Geneva when he was around five with his family. And he came back in 1933 to help settle his mother's estate. And here I'm showing you the Dove block, and on the left, Dove's family home, which you may recognize because it's right on Main Street. So Dove was born in 1880. His family moved to Geneva in 1885. He went to Hobart College in Geneva and then transferred to Cornell. And after graduation, he moved to New York City, and he took up work as a magazine illustrator. He married Florence Dorsey in 1904. She was another Geneva native. And by the time, so I'm just going to give you a sense of what happened between the time he married Florence and the time he came back to Geneva in 1933, a lot happened in his life. He had decided he wasn't keen on being a magazine illustrator for his entire life, so he had decided to become a real artist. He'd traveled to France with Florence. He exhibited a painting in Paris. He moved back to New York, where he met Alfred Stieglitz. He decided to abandon art and become a farmer for a brief stint. He decided to be an artist after all. He left Florence for the artist Helen Torr. He moved with Helen Torr to a houseboat on the Harlem River, and then he moved once again with Torr to a 42-foot yawl called the Mona, which he sailed around Manhattan before mooring it semi-permanently on the North Shore of Long Island. He had the first of a series of what would become annual exhibitions at Stieglitz's galleries. And as Jim said, he met the DC-based collector and museum proprietor, Duncan Phillips, who would support Dove for the rest of his career, in exchange, I should say, for first dibs on paintings that Dove exhibited every year at Stieglitz's. And this caused no small amount of friction between Stieglitz and Phillips, but that's a story for another time. All right, so what I'm showing you here is what the third floor of the building looks like now, and we have to clean it up. We have to fix everything. I think many of us will be sad to see the bathtub go.
We're gonna keep it in the basement.
Well, we did actually talk about this, and we thought that some of the remnants that we have to clean out to make a proper building that could house a business or something, we decided to keep some of those remnants because surely some artist down the road would have something to do with them. So at the top is a photo composite, so a combination of photos that shows you what the third floor looked like when Dove used it as a studio. So he initially moved in with his parents, in his parents' home when he came back in 1933, but that he wasn't keen on that, so he moved to the third floor of the Dove block with Tor. And you can see on the left a bed, there's a couch in the middle, a chair, and some other sort of bed-like couch thing on the right. And he used this wall, which is right here, to display his paintings. And it's pretty interesting because something happened. Geneva was an important place for Dove, and something happened on that third floor, something about the light, something about seeing the paintings exhibited on the wall. And you'll see he actually has blank canvases hanging up on the wall, which suggests that he wanted to see what the painting might look like before it was painted on the wall. So that wall was really important to him. Something happened, something catalyzed in this space. And he wrote a letter saying that his paintings, when hung up on this wall on the third floor, looked big. And by big, he didn't mean they looked large size-wise. He meant that they had a certain kind of force. And so this space, the town of Geneva, the wall, were catalytic in producing or helping him become the artist he became in the 1930s, which I really do feel are his signature years. This is when he made some of his most exquisite pictures. Pictures like these. These were all made in the Geneva period, and they're pretty extraordinary pictures. On the upper left is Lake Afternoon from 1935. On the upper right is Sun on the Lake from, we'll just say 1937. We'll call it that. On the lower left is Willows from 1937, and on the lower right is Tree Forms Number 2 from 1935. Now, there are a lot of stories to tell about Dove, and I'm not going to go on and on about how important Geneva was for him. Just let it be said that it was, and I will write the book that Jim wants me to write and explain it all in there. But I do want to emphasize that if it weren't for Geneva, for Dove, there's been a kind of story that has lingered in scholarship that Dove hated Geneva. He hated his father. He didn't want to come back. And maybe he didn't want to come back initially. But it's not clear that his experience was at all negative in Geneva, because when you read his letters, when you read the notes that he took while living here, and when you see the paintings, it's so obvious that this was a place of immense importance to him, both as a subject matter for his art, but also also as a vital catalyst, as a space for production for his pictures. So I'm not going to talk about that tonight. What I do want to talk about are Dove's paintings of music. And given the events of later this evening, I think this is an appropriate subject. What you're looking at here is a painting entitled George Gershwin, I'll Build a Stairway to Paradise. And Dove painted it in 1927. So I'm going to spend the rest of my time up here at the podium talking a little bit about Dove's interest in and his attempts to paint sound, and in particular musical sound, although I will talk about other kinds of sounds as well. So Dove, in the 1920s, and 1927 in particular, decided to run an experiment. And that experiment involved listening to a record on his acoustic phonograph. He had a Victor Victrola phonograph, and paint while he was listening to the music. And he made a series of paintings while listening to phonograph records on his Victor Victrola phonograph. And we know it was acoustic because he was living on the boat at the time, and it hadn't been. And this is what scholars like myself try to figure out. I needed to know if it had been wired for electricity, and I actually found out that it had not. So we know that the phonograph was acoustic. So over the course of about a year, he undertook this experiment, and he produced at least 5 identifiable canvases. And I'll be focusing on 4 of those tonight, because only 4 survive. So this is George Gershwin, "I'll Build a Stairway to Paradise." And I'm going to pause here and go out of my presentation, because I want to play you the music so that you have a sense of what Dove was listening to and experiencing while he painted this. And so this is going, none of this tech is elegant. So you're going to have to bear with me as I open up my Spotify account. And also turn up the volume so you can hear it. Okay, let me just turn up the volume. All right, so this is "I'll Build a Stairway to Paradise." And if it's on low volume, I'll turn it up. Okay, so that is, see, I told you this wasn't very elegant. All right, so he also painted these 2 works. And I love the titles of these 2 works. On the left is George Gershwin, Rhapsody in Blue, Part 1. And on the right is George Gershwin, Rhapsody in Blue, Part 2. And what's interesting about Part 1 is he's actually affixed a metal spring from inside of, this was pulled from a broken phonograph. He's affixed it to the surface of the picture. So, and the picture, this is a kind of shadow box frame. So the spring is affixed to the surface of the canvas, and then it's all put inside of a box. And so these were painted while Dove was listening to Rhapsody in Blue. And we know what recordings he was listening to because he kept diaries, and he noted when he bought records and he noted what records they were. So these were all, "I'll Build a Stairway to Paradise" was a Paul Whiteman Orchestra recording on the Victor labels. Rhapsody in Blue was also a Victor recording of the Paul Whiteman Orchestra, which I'll play for you now. This is a much more well-known tune, and for a while I think United Airlines was using it in their commercials and absolutely ruined it. Okay, so here it is. So you have to imagine that Dove, so it's an acoustic phonograph, and I'll just explain this as the music runs and you look at the pictures. It's an acoustic phonograph, and he's playing 78 RPMs, and that means that each side of the record has about 3 or 4 minutes worth of music on it. And these took days to paint. So he's moving back, he's cranking the phonograph, he's going to the easel to paint, the crank winds down, he goes back to the phonograph, he cranks it again, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth over the course of days. And in the case of Part 1 and Part 2, he has to flip the record over. They're called Part 1 and Part 2 because the composition was unusual for the time. It was around 6 minutes long, the Whiteman Orchestra version of it. And so it was split on an A and a B side of the record. So that's side A, and this is side B. So let me Let me pause that. I promise the back and forth is going to stop in just a minute. But, you know, there's nothing wrong with listening to good jazz, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. So this is the final of the four paintings that survive from this series of paintings made while listening to phonograph records while on his boat, the Mona. This is called Orange Grove in California by Irving Berlin. And these were all made in 1927. And they're all fully abstract, and they're all named after the compositions that to which Dove listened while he was painting, and the song to which he listened was also a Paul Whiteman Orchestra recording on a Victor release, and I will play this for you because this may be a less well known piece. And the sound quality isn't great because these are phonograph records, right? So what you're hearing is the music, but also the needle, not the needle spinning on the record, but the needle that's recording the music on the plastic disc while it's being played live in the studio. Okay? All right. So I don't think I have too much more of the back and forth here. So for the young folk in the audience, that's what a record looks like, in case you were wondering. So as I said, that's what his phonograph looked like. That's what the record looked like that he had to put on it. And as I said, he went back and forth between the machine emitting sound and the blank canvas that gradually over time while the machine emitted sound on which a painting emerged. And I'm showing you here the boat on which he did this. This is the Mona. This is Dove's boat. It's amazing what archives yield. So he's on that boat with his phonograph and his easel painting. And this is a Dove and Helen Torr roundabout 1838 or 18. Did I say 18? Yes, sorry. around 1838, 1839. Okay? Now, I said it again. So I should tell you, full disclosure, that I thought I was a scholar of 19th century American art. And I was telling folks this over lunch. I was in graduate school, I was doing dissertation research at the Phillips Collection. I was writing about the 19th century American painter George Innes, and I was doing serious, important, smart, intelligent work. And I thought I would take a break one day and go look at the pretty modern pictures. You know, because what's difficult about those? And so I went upstairs, and there was a Major Dove retrospective on view. This was 1997. It's a long time ago. They kind of blew my mind. I didn't know at what I was looking. I'd never seen anything like it. And the seed was planted. The proverbial bee in the bonnet had been unleashed. So I had to get through the dissertation. I had to get a job. I had to get tenure. And I finally written the book. This is why I tend always to assume everything happened in the 19th century, because that's where I began. Okay, so Dove was not the first person to paint music. He wasn't the only person to do it, and he was certainly not the first. And I'm showing you some examples from around the time period that he's doing this to give you a sense of this. So on the upper left is a painting by Georgia O'Keeffe. Dove and O'Keeffe were quite close. They were friends as well as they also mutually influenced one another's art. And that is O'Keeffe's Pink and Blue Number 1 from 1918. Music, Pink and Blue Number 1. So this is her rendition of the idea of music. On the lower left is Franz Kupka, who is a Czech, or was a Czech artist. And that is called Amorpha Fugue in Two Colors from 1912. On the lower right is a painting by Vasily Kandinsky, a Russian painter, called Improvisation Number 7, Storm from 1910. And then on the upper right is a painting by Aaron Douglas called Aspects. It was part of a mural Carol that used the period term for African-American aspects of Negro life, Song of the Towers, and he created it in 1934. And so these are all examples of artists in this general time period who are experimenting with what it might be to translate sound into pictorial form, which itself isn't an obvious translation, right? Because sound isn't visible to the eye. We can see a sheet of music, we can see a phonograph record, we can see the phonograph, but we can't see sound. So the question is, how does one translate that into pictorial form? And these are four examples of that. So Dove was not a pioneer when it came to translating musical sound into pictorial form. But like voting in Chicago, he did it early and he did it often. and I say this because I want to emphasize that this was not a sidestep, a mere experiment. This was a fundamental and essential part of his practice. Painting music and all sorts of kinds of sounds, which I'll talk about in a moment, was a real preoccupation for Dove. And it's one of the reasons I became so preoccupied with him myself. And so these are some of the earliest experiments on his part with engaging musical sound in pictorial form. On the left is Sentimental Music from around 1913, and on the right is Movement Number 1 from 1911. And both of these are pastel works. He is one of the masters of pastel in the early 20th century. These when you see these in person, the pastel doesn't even look like it's bound to the paper ground. It looks like it's floating magically above the surface. They're truly astounding. And here what he's doing isn't so much, he didn't make these while listening to music. Here what he's doing is in a way finding abstract form that for him conjures the idea of music or his experience of thinking about music or listening to music. So it's almost as if he's trying to conjure or materialize in a work of art the flow of music through air. You can these undulating and spinning forms sort of do feel as if he's trying to figure out, well, if I could see music undulating through air, what would that look like? So not music, a specific piece of music, but the idea of music. This is another example of an engagement with musical sound. This is a painting entitled Me and the Moon that Dove created in response to a tune that he heard on the radio. He loved the radio. One of the myths that I intended to debunk with my book was that Dove hated people, he didn't like machines, he moved to the North Shore of Long Island to get away from the silliness and muck of the city, and all he wanted to do was sit around and subjectively experience trees and flowers. No, not at all. He loved the movies, he loved going into New York, he loved people, he played in a band, a sort of informal band that probably involved as much drinking as it did playing, but he loved the radio. He loved listening to the radio. So this is entitled Me and the Moon, and he created it not while listening to the song, because that was an ephemeral experience, but after the fact of hearing it played on the radio. And this is a song, music and lyrics, by Lou Handman and Walter Hirsch. Multiple artists recorded the song in 1936. This was painted in 1937, including Bing Crosby, whose version was a huge radio hit. If you want to hear it, I'll play it for you in the Q&A, but I don't want to overburden you with too much back and forth. Here's another example. This is entitled The Moon Was Laughing at Me, and it was inspired also by a popular radio song called The Moon Is Grinning at Me, and this had been recorded in 1936 by Ben Pollock and his orchestra, but also by the Mills Blue Rhythm Band. And Dove slightly altered the title. So the radio song was The Moon Is Grinning at Me, and Dove's title is The Moon Was Laughing at Me, which I think for Dove more directly reflected the theme of the song. And the song is sung by a man who was spurned by the young woman who was the object of his affection. And this bad luck causes the moon to mock him. So the moon is laughing at this man as he's moping about, sad about his unrequited crush. Here is another example. This is Swing Music Louis Armstrong from 1938. And this is actually one of the paintings that was hanging on the wall in the Dove Block picture, the historic photo that I showed you. It was in the lower right-hand portion. It's not exactly known what the source for this painting was. Obviously, we know it's Louis Armstrong, but we don't know if Dove listened to a record, if he heard it on the radio. We do know, and this is the likely source, that he went to see the movie Artists and Models, which starred Jack Benny and Ida Lupino, and featured Louis Armstrong, this amazing scene where Louis Armstrong emerges from around a corner, and the first thing you see is his trumpet come around the corner. It's incredible. And he plays a song called Public Melody, number one, which is a play on the idea of Public Enemy, number one. And this opened, the movie opened in 1937 in New York, and Dove wrote in his diaries that he saw it. Shortly before, he wrote in his diaries that he began working on this painting called Louis Armstrong. So chances are he was inspired by the film. So Me and the Moon Was Laughing at Me, Swing Music, Louis Armstrong. These are not made while listening to music. They're also not pictures that mean to evoke the general idea of musical form. They materialize the memory of listening. So what I'm describing here are different taxonomies of music paintings, right? Paintings created while listening to music, paintings that evoke the idea of music, and these paintings that materialize the memory of Dove's listening to the radio, at the movies, to his favorite musicians, among them Louis Armstrong. And just so you have a sense of this, he wrote in his diary on September 28th, 1936, the following, and I'm quoting, "Heard some really good music on Joe's radio yesterday. It started me on abstractions again." So he hears music on the radio, and you don't think that, I mean, this is a kind of counterintuitive source of abstraction. Some guy listening to the radio in the 1930s and then making that, right? You don't think of abstract painting coming out of something so quotidian and mundane, but for Dove, it did, and that's another reason I find his work so fascinating. Now, I said that he did not restrict himself to musical sound, and he didn't. Here's a great example of that. He painted pictures of all kinds of sound, machine sound, natural sound. This is foghorn sound. This is entitled Foghorns from 1929. And it exemplifies the fact that Dove was fascinated by all things sonic, all things that had a sonic quality. And his brother recalled that even as a child, Dove was keen on music and owned several musical instruments and was always building and crafting things that would make musical-like noise. And Paul also said, "My brother would paint, quote, anything from a knothole in a tree trunk to the wind in the willows, the sound in the telephone wires, the moo of a cow or the coo of a pigeon or the clouds and sunrise." I love that quote. He's painting things he sees, but also things he hears. So here he's painting that long, deep blast of a foghorn. And he represents the sound moving through space and time by these bands of purplish and purple gray and plum that he's arranged into concentric circles that march across one. There's a little one in the back that originate in the back and kind of march across the canvas as if coming forward in space and time to convey the idea of that blast traveling through the air. And there's also something wonderful about these because they also make me feel as if I'm looking into the bell of a brass horn. So there's a kind of literalization of the idea of a fog horn here. Or even, and this is more speculative, but I also like to think of this as creating something like an inside joke for Dove, where here in a picture of foghorn sound, by the way of painting the bell of a brass instrument, maybe he's bringing Louis Armstrong into the mix, right? And making a connection between the blast of a foghorn and the blast of Armstrong's trumpet. Here's another example. of a sound painting. This is Thunder Shower from 1940. And, you know, no paintings literally make sound, right? And one could say a painting of anything could perhaps evoke sound. But here there's something about the way Dove configures his colors and his shapes that suggest, especially that yellow squiggle that slices through the middle of the canvas, that he really wants us to hear the crack of lightning as it streaks through the sky. There's a way in which that squiggle of yellow suggests the canvas itself cracking open. So this is another way in which he's trying to figure out, how do I make sound happen in a picture? Here's another example. This is the hilariously titled Fire in a Sauerkraut Factory from 1936. I know. Apparently, he witnessed a fire in a sauerkraut factory. He did, in fact, yes. And he wrote about it. And this is the painting. It's not a great reproduction. Obviously, that's the frame. And he wrote about it. And this is what he said. And he wrote this in a letter to Tor. He witnessed this fire in 1934. And he wrote, "It was a beauty of a fire. With the high," right, only an artist would say that, "with the high tension wires running white violet fireworks all over the building. White light ran out the wires to a switch box on a pole and set off an octave higher color pinwheel and violet orange. The people would all scatter when it went off. Sounded as though," and this is the best line, "sounded as though someone had run a zipper down between two rows of machine guns." So he's seen the fire, and he's hearing the fire and trying to put that into a picture. It wasn't always fun and games for him. This is a painting entitled A Neighborly Attempt at Murder from 1941. And this is a painting that he made. Just ignore this stuff. These are super high-res images that I got from the museums when I was publishing my book. This is a painting he made in response to overhearing a woman attempt, and this is kind of grim, so apologies, attempt to murder her family in the house next door while he was living in Centerport, New York. She didn't murder her family. She wound up committing suicide, and Dove recounted in a letter to Stieglitz what the experience of overhearing this violence was. And so here, what he's trying to do is conjure what the experience of him hearing something so awful. So this isn't purposeful listening. It's a kind of inadvertent listening or overhearing, hearing against one's will, one might say. So the point I'm making here is that Dove painted a lot of sound. And one of the questions that interested me when I came to write about Dove, and I'm just going to briefly answer that, answer this question, was why? Why? What was at stake in it for him? And I've given you some sense of this as I've been speaking. And there are many ways to answer this question, why paint sound? And I'll give you two answers that I've come up with. One is an artistic answer. For him, it was a matter of representing something in a painting that cannot be seen, right? Because art for hundreds of years in the Western tradition was about depicting things that were visible in the world. Those things might look different in a painting. That's the whole point of painting. Otherwise, we'd just look out our windows and be done with it. But the point of painting in the Western tradition for hundreds of years had been to paint things that could be seen. And I think Dove, I mean, he was really ambitious. And I think he wanted to see what would happen if he painted something that couldn't be seen. And so he experimented with all these different kinds of sounds in order to do that. And here I'm showing you two of the painters that Dove would have encountered at Stieglitz's gallery. On the left is a painting by Pablo Picasso, Still Life with Bottle of Rum, 1912. And this is a really wonderful portrait made by Francis Picabia of Alfred Stieglitz. It's actually really funny. I don't have time to go into it, but it's really funny and quite bawdy. Anyway, I mean, you might be able to imagine why on your lonesomes all by yourselves. But this is I'm showing you these two things because this is the kind of ambitious painting I'm talking about, right? So this is what Picasso does with a still life, right? All of a sudden, a still life is not about objects sitting on a table in a world. All of a sudden, a portrait, this is what Picabia does to a portrait. All of a sudden, a portrait is about something wholly other than rendering a likeness of the sitter. And Dove was ambitious along the lines of artists like Picabia and Picasso, and he was inspired by their ambition. I mean, Picasso, in a sense, set out to destroy painting and remake it. And I think this was a pretty attractive proposition to Dove. He was also inspired, I think, by the kinds of visualizations that were emerging in period science, because he was aware of advanced ideas, both in the humanities and the sciences, made available to the layperson through popular periodicals and journals. And he was especially fascinated, as many artists were at the time, with the increased attention in the scientific realm during this period. And we're talking about the first few decades of the 20th century, to a whole range of newly theorized but not yet observed phenomena. Things that only exist as a hypothesis because they hadn't been seen yet. They hadn't been empirically observed. So, for instance, the structure of the atom or atomic structure. This was the moment at which people were figuring out or hypothesizing what the structure of the atom looked like. For a long time, the atom was thought to be the smallest particle in the universe. And then people figured out, oh, well, there's a nucleus, there are electrons, there are protons. And then people began to realize that those protons and electrons didn't behave in an orderly fashion. And so visualizations like these in the sciences, this is from a book about the Bohr theory of the atom. Dove was fascinated by pictures like this that weren't so much illustrations of a thing that had been seen, but pictures made as pictures that were themselves hypotheses. So the act of visualization in the science was interesting for Dove because it was a kind of thinking machine. Making pictures like this served as a thinking machine for scientists, and I think Dove saw his practice that way as well. So in pictures like this, this is Sun Drawing Water from 1933, which he actually made as he was first arriving in Geneva. So in a picture like this and then back to Moon, he's doing something similar. I mean, here, this doesn't look anything like the North Shore of Long Island, right? If you came back from a walk on the beach and said, oh yeah, this is what I saw, well, we need verification. Or maybe we'd clean your glasses off. But that's what Dove is interested in here are processes that can't be seen. So evaporation, the traversal of light waves through the atmosphere. We can see the effects of these things, right? We can feel the humidity on our skin. We can see things illuminated by the sun, but we can't actually see waves of light, and we can't actually see the process of evaporation. And Dove here is attempting, and you know, I don't think it's a coincidence that he's attempting in a kind of diagrammatic manner to evoke the idea of water molecules undergoing a process of transmutation. The same thing here. I've always thought that the different bands of color represent something like the phases of the moon. And we can't see the moon, and I'm going to say something that's going to sound wholly inaccurate scientifically, but when our perception is that the moon gets bigger and smaller over time. We know that's not what happens, right? But we can't actually see it expand and contract. We can stand like this for days on end, and we can't actually see those transitions. So here, what I think Dove is trying to do is give visual form to something like the lunar phase. So that's the artistic explanation, the ambition of an artist in the early decades of the 20th century to make painting do something that it simply should not be able to do. And I promise I'm wrapping up here. Back to Me and the Moon, the historical explanation. It's hard for us to recapture this. And believe me, when I'm in the classroom and I'm trying to explain to students how revolutionary the radio was. It's like, what? What's the radio? I knew I was of a specific generation when I printed out some photographs and put them in frames. These were photographs that I'd taken on my phone of my daughter. She said to me, how did those get out of the phone? Wow. Anyway, nothing to do with Dove, but in this period, and I think one of the reasons Dove is listening to the phonograph and he's fascinated by radios, because in the period, new sound technologies, new communication technologies were strange and wondrous. They were radical in their newness. I mean, think about it. Sound traveling wirelessly through miles and miles of space so that a person in Geneva and a person in Rochester could hear the same thing at the same time, even though, you know, they're an hour by car away from one another. The idea that music could happen and then find its way into a plastic circle and then get stuck on a machine and make that music happen again. In the time period, people found this marvelous, and people described radio and phonography, even the telephone. And Dove was fascinated by the telephone. He and Tor had this whole series of private jokes about how they had a ghost living in their telephone that talked to them. But technologies like these that collapsed space and time and that made sound available simultaneously to multiple people found these marvelous. People found these wondrous. And there was a real discourse about the near occult nature of these technologies. And so I think in a painting like this one, you know, Dove is in a sense giving us a picture of the song, right? Me and the moon. Here's me, here's Dove, and there's the moon, right? And it reflects the content of the song. But he's also with these undulating bands and this fishing line like wire that courses through the sky. He's also trying to envision or incarnate and paint the idea of the sound magically traversing through the stratosphere. And what's interesting about these lines is that in the early period of radio, you couldn't just find a station anywhere. Sometimes you had to, it's just like when we take our cell phones out and we do this, right, and we're trying to find a signal. Well, maybe I only have to do that, but people used to have to do that with radio signals, and it was called DX. Fishing, and people would go out with their transmitters and look for signals so that they could hear. And so this was called DX fishing. And there's something about these lines that feel like it's someone's casting out and trying to reel sound in. And so these are period specific in that they want to capture the wondrousness and the marvel of sound technology. And Dove himself said, and I'll say this in closing, he asked a series of questions about these new sound technologies, like the radio. He said, again, in expressing his sense of the magic and wonder of these technologies, he asked a series of questions about what connecting at a distance through hearing might look like, right? So radio connects people at a distance through sound. Phonography connects people at a distance through sound. The telephone connects people at a distance through sound. And he asked, what might this look like? What might this connection look like? And here's what he said. How do you feel about a person when you're talking over the phone? If you know them, if you don't know them, do you get something? Do you put that into words of your own from what they say or from what you think? Or if it were music over the radio, have you ever tried to think how it would look? And I think this, in a way, is an answer to that question. It might not be the right answer or the correct answer, but it's Dove's answer. So to close, I just want to say that Dove's project was an ambitious one, and it was a project that was sustained by Geneva and his studio in the Dove Block. It was wildly ambitious, it was experimental, it might have even been impossible, but isn't the best art the art that attempts the impossible? And I think Dove knew this. He was interviewed in 1938 by an author who was preparing a book on contemporary art, and in the archives we have this series of questions that the author gave him, and Dove scrawled his responses on. So there are these neatly typed questions, and then Dove scrawls his responses under them. And so a neatly typed question, this neatly typed question appears: what is your artist credo, or your conception of what it is the artist undertakes to do? And Dove wrote, and I wish I had brought a photograph of this document. He wrote in huge sweeping letters, "The impossible." That's it. Thanks, guys.
So I'm sure Rachel will be glad to entertain any questions you might have. This is wonderful.
Whoa, that was bright. Sorry about that. And I am more than happy to answer any and all questions. Or here, let me just turn. There, that's a little more civilized. Okay, yes, in the back.
Like in Neil Bloom, do you know if he had exposure to Kandinsky before painting these?
Or? Yes, he did. He was quite interested in Kandinsky, and he read Kandinsky's, and now I'm not remembering the title. Not on the spiritual and art, the other one, Point and Line and Plane. I think so Stieglitz published part of the On the Spiritual and Art in Camera Work, so he would have read that, but he was especially interested in the book that Kandinsky wrote that was about different kinds of translations, and so the translation of solid form into pictorial form, but also the translation of sound into musical notes. And we know that Dove read this because Dove wrote a lot. He wrote poetry. It wasn't great poetry, but he wrote it. But he mused in writing a lot. And he took a big section of this book by Kandinsky. I think it's called From Point and Line to Plane. And he rewrote it in Dovian terms. And so he absolutely had Kandinsky in Dovian terms. It becomes something, you know, wacky and wonderful. And even humorous. Dove was really funny. One of the reasons I loved writing about Dove so much is because he's very funny. So part of the rewriting of Kandinsky might have been a matter of parody, because he wasn't a huge fan of the high seriousness of modern art. He wanted to have fun with it. But all that is to say that, yes, Kandinsky is absolutely in there, and a lot of his art isn't so much a derivation of Kandinsky, but was shaped by his encounter with that artist and his ideas.
Dove drank.
Did Dove? Oh, yeah. They all did.
Was it part of the music, the art, drinking?
He wasn't a heavy drinker. I mean, he would socialize. I mean, he was a very social person, and so he would get together with people and make meals with them and have a drink with them. He would go out for a drink or two in New York, where he was quite often setting up his shows. O'Keefe, actually, interestingly, was the person who helped Dove figure out how to install his shows at Stieglitz's gallery. So he wasn't someone who drank excessively. In fact, he made a very funny portrait of a friend of his who he did think drank excessively. And the portrait is kind of about the fact of drinking excessively. But it was part of the social world of artists in this time. Yeah.
Did he mentor anybody?
In terms of having a proper student or pupil, no. I mean, I think he mentored people among his own cohort. So O'Keefe, Marin, Hartley, Demuth, they mentored one another because, in a sense, they were trailblazers. They had European precedence, but they didn't have anyone before them in the States that had modeled exactly what they wanted to do. But in terms of followers or students, not so much. Although. Many artists who worked in the second half of the 20th century, including some who are still alive today, cite Dove as an influence. So it was more informal and unofficial than not. Yeah?
Rachel, there was a slide that you showed that had George O'Keefe, that was forced into the George O'Keefe. When you showed that, mm-hmm. before you stated that was George O'Keefe, I thought you were going to say that was Arthur Dove.
Mm-hmm.
And the influence of others. And we brought this up during lunch. Who influenced who? That, I swore that that would have been a double. Yeah. It's surprising. And the other thing is, the date that you gave was 1913.
Yeah.
For that, which was relatively early. So when did he start going abstract? I know he changed his color palette.
Yeah, so...
When did he go abstract?
He started making abstract paintings in 1910 and 1911, so very early, which is why he's usually described as the first. And I think he, in a literal sense, was. But in terms of O'Keeffe and Dove, O'Keeffe found Stieglitz and Stieglitz found O'Keeffe at the same time Dove found Stieglitz and Stieglitz found Dove. And so there's a way in which a kind of triangulation among those three happened, and that it was a triangulation of a kind of mutual influence. But I think Dove and O'Keeffe were very, very close, and O'Keeffe had for years in her house in New Mexico a couple of paintings by Dove, including a lovely painting called Golden Storm, and she treasured them. And I don't think Dove ever possessed any of O'Keeffe's paintings, but she helped him pick out a couple of Stieglitz equivalents that he managed to purchase. Why Stieglitz didn't give them to him, I'll never figure out. But the bond between them was quite strong, and so I think they were, I don't think it was, I'm making this a much too long answer than it should be, but I don't think it was a matter of one influencing the other, but it was, yes, it was kind of a, what's the word, there was a kind of syncretism or something between the
did
two.
Did she ever make it to Geneva?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah.
While he was painting in the Dove.
Yes, yes, yeah. And, you know, I would have loved to time travel and be a fly on a wall for that. Georgia O'Keeffe on the third floor of the Dove block, that would have been pretty marvelous. I mean, part of the problem with Dove and O'Keeffe is that the, you know, Stieglitz engineered a critical discourse about O'Keeffe, and Dove was involved in this. And so some of the critics in Stieglitz's circle decided that the way to sell O'Keeffe was to sell her as a woman painter. She was the, and this is a quote from Paul Rosenfeld, Dove is the man in painting, O'Keeffe is the woman, and we're sort of sending them both into the world as the kind of yin and yang of painting. And both Dove and O'Keeffe thought that was pretty stupid. And O'Keeffe rebelled against that discourse all her life, and I think it's finally, she took off. I think she was tired of it at a certain point and just moved away. But I think that rhetoric has been so strong that it's prevented people from seeing Dove and O'Keeffe as really, in a way, working collaboratively, not working in parallel lines, but really working collaboratively.
In the back.
Any evidence that Dove ever experienced synesthesia or was involved with any substances that are associated with synesthesia?
You know, that's a great question, and I've had to answer that, and I part of me wishes the answer was yes, but it really is no. And people have written about Dove and synesthesia, but it never came up in Dove's writings. It never came up in writing about Dove during the time. You know, he wrote down how many eggs he had for breakfast. So if he was experimenting with
blocks of hashish,
he probably would have written that down, and that just wasn't part of the scene. It was more, I mean, to get back to the drinking question, it was more have a beer in the evening scene. And so this is not to suggest that some of what Dove was doing isn't quite like the idea of synesthesia, where one sensory experience substitutes for another, or if you hear music, you see a color. I mean, this is a real neurological phenomenon. But I don't think it's part of the Dove story. It's part of a larger modern art in the 20th century story, but I don't think it's part of the Dove story.
Rachael, I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
How did he deal with the fact that he sold so few paintings? Mm-hmm. Phillips bought them, but probably almost no one else did, or I don't know that, you probably do. How did he deal with the fact that he was doing a life's work? He knew what he was doing. He knew how important it was, and very few others ever did.
You know, Dove was not an angsty guy. I think scholarship has wanted him to be angsty because that modern artists are supposed to be. But I don't. He wasn't averse to a public. I think he would have loved people to be excited about his art and to buy it. But there is a way in which he was making it for himself, and that was enough. And that Stieglitz and Phillips, two men he admired, and whose thinking about art he found incredibly profound, I think that was enough for him. I mean, this doesn't mean that his letters and diaries aren't filled with worry over money. I mean, but for him, it was less about... It wasn't a worry, oh, nobody likes my art, I'm not successful. Because, you know, even Marin and Hartley had more of a public presence than he did. The worry is more financial. How am I going to buy dinner? And there are letters that say, excuse me, Duncan, I need dinner. And so Duncan would send him $5. But I don't think he was overly anxious about it. Yeah. Yes.
How many art pieces did he actually create? I mean, I know many are in museums more
yeah.
than in private collection, but he must have made thousands.
Yeah, so I don't think he made thousands. He might have made 1,000. He wasn't hugely prolific, but he wasn't Vermeer either. So I would, you know, I would ballpark it. And I've actually never, and maybe now I should probably count just so I can answer this question next time, but he did paint a lot. He made hundreds and hundreds of watercolors in addition to the painting, so that might increase it out to a couple of thousand. But he did, I mean, he was somebody who always, aside from the period where he decided he needed to be a farmer, he was somebody who always felt like he needed to paint. He was always compelled to paint. And he didn't belabor paintings. They were usually completed in a couple of weeks or a couple of months. And they're by and large small scale. So there are quite a few of them. And many major museums have a critical mass. The Phillips Collection, the Art Institute, Boston. There are others I could mention. Yeah.
A couple more.
Okay, I'm struck by two things as you're talking, and everybody, you know, reads something. He depicts often a sun or a moon in a kind of a magical spiritual situation, almost Asian. In fact, Sauerkraut Fire actually has a serpent in the middle that looks like a serpent.
Well, that's the pinwheel of fire that coursed across the electrical wiles, yeah.
But the orange?
Mm-hmm.
It's very Asian. Did he have any connection with the mystical or spiritual effects of the sun and the moon?
Not really, and it's an interesting question. I mean, he was tangentially associated with some of the theosophists in the early 20th century, and this was a group of thinkers who, how to say this diplomatically, who thought they were practicing or fathoming a kind of spiritual practice based in Indian spiritual practices. But that was only part of it. I mean, a lot of these early 20th century movements or groups, especially related to the occult in America, put bits and pieces of a whole bunch of stuff together. So he was tangentially associated with some of the theosophists, but that's about it. That doesn't mean it wasn't part of his thinking. It's just, as with synesthesia, it's just not something that is part of any of the historical record that we have access to. But what I tell my students is sometimes the historical record doesn't tell us everything. And I tell my students that Dove intended one thing by his paintings, but we as viewers in the 21st century can see other things in those. Do you have a follow-up? Yeah. Oh, yes, yeah, sorry.
Things that are measurable by frequency, colors,
yes.
Sounds, radio waves,
mm-hmm.
atomic energy, and how we experience them as humans, how they filter through our essence.
Yeah.
And how, and those are all... That's what I was thinking. He was receiving, how do we cope with this new technology of frequency in color expressing those frequencies.
Yeah. So this is you've put in a sense your what's the expression? Hit the nail on the head. I mean, he was interested in things that moved in waves. He was interested in the circle as a kind of fundamental form of physical phenomena and processes, and he was interested in the idea of frequency. And he was interested in sensing and registration, and one of the chapters in my book, and here I'll just, why not, plug my book, tries to figure out, you know, where painting fits in all of this. And I ultimately think, and this is what I say in the book, that for him, paintings were apparatuses that served as registration, but also filtering devices, and were meant to not just reflect the world, but be agents in it, and help him understand how a human, they were almost like translators. They were helping him as a human understand the language, let's say the frequency, let's call that the language of the natural world. These paintings were helping him translate that language so that he could, in a sense, put himself in a direct and intersubjective relationship with an entity, that is to say the natural world, the language of which he didn't exactly speak. So I know that sounded completely nutso. But again, he was ambitious, and he was also fascinated by meteorology, and he was preoccupied with the weather, maybe even more than he was with music, and he was really interested in the technologies by which people mapped and predicted the weather. And so this is another example of him being interested in how humans intersect with natural processes and attempt to in a sense, decipher them, but also figure out what language those processes speak so that the humans can speak it, too.
One more.
Yes.
Thank you, first of all, for a very interesting and talk. As you're talking about the images that he could put about sound, or his place in the universe, maybe, the me and the moon. You mentioned, or someone mentioned, when you were being introduced, that you are also writing about Darwin's tree, the evolution.
Yes.
And I just see a connection between what you're doing here and one of the most powerful images in science. Could you just elaborate on why the hell you...
Yeah, so you're absolutely right. I mean, I think even though, I mean, this is something that those of us in the academy, and I have a feeling that I'm not alone in being in that situation in this room, but, you know, at some point we have to figure out when we're going up for tenure what our trajectory is, right? Why we need to tell the people who are deciding whether or not we keep our job why it makes sense that we've done what we've done. And I mean, my work has, I don't want to say it's been all over the map, but I've tended, and maybe naively so, to write about stuff that I find interesting, right? So Innes was interesting. Dove is interesting. And I find them interesting because I see the pictures and I say, wow, that's interesting. And my husband always says, well, how do you know it's going to be interesting? It's, come on, man. Have some faith. And so Darwin I found interesting. But there's a reason I find these things interesting, and it's precisely the kinds of connections that you're describing. Because, you know, if Dove was interested in finding a way to paint something that couldn't be picturable, Darwin was attempting to make a diagram of something that can't be picturable, right? Because this is a diagram of divergence of character. And divergence of character, in a nutshell, is one of the principles of Darwin's evolutionary theory. And it's the principle that describes how species in a given region coexist and don't compete with one another. So the famous example is Darwin's finches. They have There are a bunch of different finch species in the Galapagos, and they coexist. They don't outcompete one another because their beaks are different sizes and shapes, which means each species of finch eats a different kind of seed. And they've evolved the beaks in order, I mean, it's not like they set out and said, evolve, evolve, but the beaks have evolved over time in order to allow those different finch species to coexist. That's divergence of character. Now, divergence of character happens over thousands of generations. And the tree diagram, I'm not going to take the time to pull up a picture, but it's right there. I could if I wanted to. That represents, it's the only illustration in the book, and it represents 4,000 generations. So depending on the species, that could be 30,000 years or millions of years. No picture can depict infinitesimally slow and non-visible change over 30,000 to a million years. But Darwin made a picture of it. And I'm interested, I mean, here's the thing. I'm an art historian, and it's not as if I'm telling the world for the first time what his diagram is about. You know, newsflash. I'm interested in what it is as a picture. Why did he need it? What did he think a picture would add to 500 pages about pigeon breeding? And so I'm approaching it in the same way, in a sense, as I do Dove's pictures. You know, why do they exist in the first place? So you're absolutely right to see a connection there. It's there. And once I figured that out and I could write the case so that I could keep my job, I was like, oh, it makes sense after all. There are reasons for what I do.
So it's the evolution of your job, too.
Yes, that's right. The divergence of my character. Yes. Thank you, everyone.
Terrific first Arthur Dove Memorial Lecture. We hope to do this every year. We plan to do this every year. We're delighted that she's on our board. You can talk further with him. We have wine and cheese outside. Please take advantage of a chat with her or with any of us. And please keep thinking about Arthur Dove in Geneva and a community art center in Geneva. We need you. Love to have you.